Over the past few years, we have learned that disasters can hit pretty much at any time. Oftentimes, they're really unexpected. And that's what we're going to be talking about with you today. My name is Jim Mayhew, and I am with Above the Influence. And I'm joined by my friend and co-host today, Julie Hansen. Yes. And Julie has an interest in helping people be prepared for disasters. So, yes. How are you today?
I'm doing well. Thanks for having me.
Yeah. So tell us a little bit about yourself, Julie.
Okay, I've grown up in Benton County. I've lived here most of my life. I lived in Linn County for a little while. I'm a nurse. Again, I have two boys. My husband works here in town as the emergency management coordinator. And I've always had an interest in preparedness. And so I've looked into some things, and most everything I've learned is because I've read it and I've gone and searched it out a little bit. There's a lot of good information. So it's an easy topic to look at and find information on.
Yeah, that's great. So let's just start right there. Let's start with the basics today. So when you use the word preparedness, help our viewers and help me understand, what do you mean? How do you qualify that?
Okay, I think it's a term that should not cause us to feel anxiety or fear, because we do it all the time. If you prepare a diaper bag for a weekend that you're going away, or if you winterize your car, you're doing preparedness. And it's something that we all think of anymore because Vinton and Benton County has been hit with some disasters. We all have been aware and been told, and it's been published, that we should have at a minimum of up to like 3 days of water stored up, and well, this food and ways to cook it maybe, and some of your other essentials, just to be prepared for what may happen unexpectedly.
Yeah.
And so preparedness basically is just thinking ahead for yourself so that you're not caught with nothing that you would seem as needing to be necessary in your life,
yeah,
especially for a couple days.
Yeah. So you had mentioned just in our area, we've experienced some of those things, but could you identify some of the events that might be classified as disasters? Just so we all know what we're talking about here. Maybe the obvious, yeah, ones, and there's probably some that are a little, yeah, less obvious.
Yeah. The obvious one would be weather-related things. We had an ice storm a number of years ago. Mm-hmm. We've had power outages because of the derecho, the windstorm that came in 2011. Of course, the floods of 2008 and 16 and a variety of things like that. Of course, the pandemic also,
yeah,
now has caused us to be sheltered in place for a while. It's not been real hard, though, because we still have transportation. We still have grocery stores that have food. We have medicine and help available all the time. So it's not a real bad test, but it gives you an idea of what would happen if we were really socked in for a long time.
Yeah. No, that's really good to understand, because all of those, they just upset what we, yeah, consider normal.
Yeah.
And so it's our ability to adjust for that.
Yeah.
So one of the things that I want to talk with you about today, I want to transition into talking about those eight aspects of wellness. And so, mm-hmm, I'm just going to run through them again real quick. So we're talking mental health, physical health, social, environmental, emotional, vocational, financial, and spiritual. So those, mm-hmm, are the eight aspects. And so you and I had a moment to kind of talk about this a few minutes ago. And Julie, what are the advantages that preparedness helps you, I guess, be prepared for?
Okay.
How does that impact any of these eight dimensions of wellness?
I think of like when I've been working at getting a bug out bag ready, it just helps me know that I have access to things that I will be very appreciative of having in the future if I need to have them immediately. It causes me to have less anxiety and fear, yeah, about the unknown. I don't have to have a panic button in my head that goes off. I can think, okay, I've already prepared for that. What do I have and where is it? And things like that. When a person does prepare some also, they're likely to have less sense of losses in their life during that critical time. Whether it's, again, emotional, you have a loss of peace, you have a loss of contentment, you have a loss of maybe cutting off from relationships that because you don't know how to connect with each other, you don't know where they're at. You have a loss at times of physical health because maybe you don't have the meds. You wish you had some things for security, like some mace or pepper spray, or you wish you had a knife or you had some other things.
Mm-hmm.
You have less fear and less anxiety when you have preparedness that you've done a little bit of.
Yeah. So the word confidence actually kind of creeps into my mind as I hear you talking,
yeah,
about that. Being prepared makes you feel like you're ready, that you have some confidence around that.
Yeah.
Is that fair?
Yeah. It can be fleeting, though, and this is where I also have to realize within that, I can only prepare so much because there's not going to be one person that's prepared for 100% mm-hmm. of the disasters that could happen. You know, you think volcano or bioterrorism or civil unrest or weather. No one's prepared 100% for everything 100% of the time, every day of the year. Mm-hmm. That person just could not really exist. You'd have to have things at your home, at your car, at your work. You know, it would be very overwhelming. Like I could have a nice, really nice bug out bag in my car, but what if during that disaster my car is sunk under tons of concrete? The parking lot has collapsed. So was I prepared? Yes, I was. But do I have access to my preparedness stuff? No, I don't, and it's not my fault. So I always am aware that even though I can be very well prepared or minimally prepared, it can all go out the window at the moment's notice, and I have to accept that.
So that's a really great explanation. I think it's so important that we recognize that we always can't be prepared. So, another word that you brought up was it can feel overwhelming. So one of the things that I know that you're interested today is, what are some tips that you can help provide us that would lessen that feeling of being overwhelmed?
Okay. If I got to that feeling of overwhelm, that's where your aspect of spirituality comes in, or the mental health. I just have to accept those things, and hopefully I have a sense of, you know, a higher power or whatever that would help me when the best that I've done has been taken away from me. And it may happen, but I have places to go for that too. I think the government would even say, even our Benton County Health Department and Emergency Management would say they want every citizen to really have, at a minimum, 3 days of food, 3 days of water, and at least some kind of a bug out bag or some kind of a place where you have put together items that you would need if you had to leave or whatever, or stay in place. It could be in a tote bag too. It wouldn't have to be in a bag, but so somehow you know where things are collected and then you can get them as you need to. That would be the main thing right there is, again, 3 days of food and water in a bug out bag with some items in it. It could be like your medicines, an extra pair of glasses, information is included, mm-hmm. Your pharmacy number, your medications, everything like that, prescription glasses in case you had to get your prescription somewhere else in another city or state that you got shipped to. What's your prescription for your glasses?
Yeah.
You have it with you. And so there's lots of things you can do to be prepared and have things, not only items, but information.
Yeah.
You could have a lot of things on a thumb drive in your bug out bag or in your tote bag. It's also good to have them in hard copy too, because if there is no electricity, how's your iPad going to work? How's your phone going to work? It's not, because you couldn't charge it unless you had solar power. So it's good to have some things in hard copy too, mm-hmm. because you may not have electricity.
Wow, you've opened my mind up. I mean, there were some things that feel obvious, like matches and flashlights, but you just opened up a whole bunch of resources there that I wasn't even considering. I know you brought some things with us today, so here's what I'm going to propose, if this makes sense, is why don't you bring your bag out, walk us through what you suggest that's being in there, and then let's come back to how you can help people, like what resources you brought in this file folder here today to help people figure out where they can get it, and maybe even just some steps to help plan for that. Mm-hmm. Does that sound good?
Yeah, I can do that. One thing I was going to say, first of all, is I have a bug out bag that has a lot of things in it, but everything I have, though, was bought over a period of like a year and a half.
Sure,
I didn't do this in one fell swoop. Financially, you got to pace yourself out. I have to do some research, and, you know, at times I think I have bought the wrong thing. So even if I have, I don't beat myself up for it. I don't say stop doing it, never do it again. There's just times when you make a decision, and you go with it, and, you know, 5 years later you think, well, that was a bad choice. I want something different now. So then you can swap out and swap in other items. So my bug out bag is really something that is evolving. Mm-hmm. And again, I didn't do it in one day.
Yeah.
It took me time. And so don't get overwhelmed with it. And again, there is a diagram here. There's a document here that I do have access to that's like 20 weeks of preparedness. The government has made a little document out that over 20 weeks, they list out what you can buy every week or get access to every week. And by the end of 20 weeks, you should have a good-sized acclimation of things that would be helpful.
So 20 weeks, about 5 months-ish, somewhere in there. And that would help spread out costs.
Yes.
And for people like me that have a high sense of urgency, like, I want it all right now, at least that would help me have something of a plan to just to follow. And
yeah.
stay on a budget, things like
that. Stay on a budget, because it is doable. In fact, some of the things that people would say are reasons why they don't prepare is, number one, there's a conception that people are extremists or they're survivalists, and no, people that are doing preparedness nowadays are often intelligent, they're educated, they just have a sense inside, a knowing in their knower, that I need to have things, because sometimes things happen, I have no control. And so today's preppers, or people who are preparing, are really everyday people.
Yeah, that's a great reminder.
Yeah, it's not just
survivalists. Because we've all seen the TV shows.
Yep, and bad men, and, bad labels.
Right, yeah.
Redneck, survivalist, bunker mentality.
Yeah. Right.
We don't want that.
Well, let's take a look at that bag. Yes. I've been anxious to see this.
Okay. This is what my bag probably might look like. It looks like about this. And I just have a blanket that's tapped onto the side, it's rolled up and everything, from our local hospital, as you see.
Julie, my first reaction when I see this, it just looks like a backpack.
It is a basic backpack. I got it at probably a Walmart, Alco, whatever.
Yeah.
Just a basic backpack, and there's a lot of little compartments, which I do like. For example, over here, I just always have a bottle of water. Even if you're on the go, if you're having to evacuate, you're probably going to need water, so I keep a bottle of water in there. Over here, I'll just start over here. I do have a water filter bottle. This brand is one I've liked, and I may change. I may buy a different brand the next time, but this actually has a filter inside. Right there it is.
Oh, yeah.
And you can put dirty or contaminated water in there, water that's suspect. And when you suck out the water from here, it goes through the filter first, and it takes out everything from bacteria, viruses, germs, whatever. Even viruses come out, as well as all kinds of chemicals, pesticides, and everything like that. So that's another thing that I have. I always keep some gloves up in front and Kleenex. You never know when you want to protect your hands from what you're getting into. I won't go in any special order here, but like here's a bag that has some more medical or personal items. I have like a Mylar blanket. I have a pair of plastic sunglasses, contact solutions. I have my contacts. Also, I have water purification tablets in here. Each tablet will purify 1 liter of water and kill bacteria and viruses, Giardia. I have an extra pair of glasses. I have some batteries, things like that. Just a bunch of little things. I do have a cup that I can drink water from if I need to, and it collapses. Just stuff like that. Let's see. And another thing, I do have a weather radio that's solar powered. It has a hand crank, and you can crank it that way and charge the battery. It has batteries in it. It has NOAA weather alerts, everything on it. It has a flashlight up front and a red flashlight, too, besides radio, FM, AM. Here's one that has some of my more safety things. I have a can opener in here. I have a headlamp, flashlight, a headlamp.
Those are so handy because you got to keep your hands free when you're doing so much of this stuff.
Yeah, you want some source of a lighter fluid. I have just mini tools. This has all kinds of screwdrivers. I have a seatbelt cutter, a pair of pliers, which also has other things in it. They're all just real little. I have a blade, and I have a Swiss Army knife.
Yeah.
All kinds of stuff like that. Everything, as you see, I put in Ziploc baggies, because what if my bag gets totally wet? I drop it in a river or wherever I'm at, or I'm by a shelter and I'm by the water pipes and the water pipes burst. If my whole bag gets wet, I don't want wet clothes. I don't want everything like that. So I put everything in Ziploc baggies. This is more my comfort thing, and this is where if you have kids especially, I have things like Mott's fruit chews, granola bars, I have tea, I have cocoa, I have a bag of popcorn. If you're sick and tired of drinking bottled water, you have some of the flavored waters. This can just provide you comfort. And when you're on day 4 or 5 of a nasty situation, comfort, this is comfort, and it will take you far.
Yeah.
You'll be very thankful at times that you have some flavor that you can have. And so that can be very important, especially if you have kids that are cranky. I do have one pouch of 25-year shelf life food from Mountain House. Just add water, and it's got like 2.5 servings in case I was really desperate. Another thing here is for kids or anybody, if you're stuck at a shelter or in a hotel or somewhere else, I have cards, pen, marker, a crossword puzzle book, books for kids, and a notepad so people can document what's happening, kind of like a little diary. That may be fun to look at later in life. I do have a little sewing kit, which of course allows me to have scissors and things like that, which could be good. I always have a pair of work gloves in case I had to do some work outside. Okay, this is a pair of a bag of clothes. In here, I have balled up a t-shirt, socks, a pair of gloves, and a pair of like legging pants. And there's a pair of underwear there. I mean, it's like everything. And this is why you put it also in a Ziploc baggie.
Yeah.
It's actually my husband's. here's another one. This is where you take it to the shower. I have soap, dental floss, towels, washcloth, toothpaste.
Seeing like a toothbrush and toothpaste, because sometimes it's just those little things can make you feel better.
Yeah, and a little bit of deodorant and one shaver, contact solution, just things like that. I put them all in a baggie. Let's see here. I have another. I do have in here also, of course, wipes. Here's another little lamp kind of a thing. Let's see if I can get it opened up.
It's battery. I've never seen one. That's nice.
It's solar powered. You can power or charge it up by solar power. It's nothing big, but it's just little, and it doesn't cost much, and it's condensed. I like it. Here I also have a CPR face shield mask if I did need to do CPR on somebody, and I have two N95 masks.
Those are a hot item right now.
Yeah, I have just a few that I have. I've ordered some more, but they're not coming.
See, and so, even up until like this pandemic that's happened,
yes.
How many times would people neglect? I've never thought to carry in 95 masks with me before because I'm not thinking about particulates in the air or whatever it might be.
Yeah, I think of the World Towers coming down. I remember all the cement and dust in the air, and a volcano blew out by Washington. They said it would cover us with ash eventually. Mm-hmm. I mean, it would be, not that it would come immediately, but still to have some kind of mask.
Sure.
If you're near a lot of chemical thing that you could.
Well, a couple of things strike me in your bag is, first of all, I think, you said you have a nursing background or you are a nurse. And so when I perceive some of the things that you put in there, like the gloves and the masks, that really stood out to me. And that seems far beyond what maybe I've thought about from traditional, what I think about with bug out bags, which might be a little bit more tool oriented, knives and fire making things, et cetera, cording, all of that. And you did have all
paracord,
of those things too. So that was really neat. Thank you for sharing that. So why don't you tell us then, we can put in the video, we'll have a link to Julie's. So you had a report there. You said it was from .gov about how to build this out over the 20 weeks. So we'll have that. But why don't you share with us some of your other notes and ways that you have helped put these things together. Thank you for doing that, by the way.
Yes, you're welcome. I think one thing that came about, especially in a few years ago, was the word resilient. The whole thing about preparedness is to make us more resilient. It won't make us all powerful and all-knowing and everything. No one will suffer any at all, but it makes us more resilient. In a disaster, we come back easier with more mental health, with more spirituality, with more intactness in our financial, whatever, lives. We're more resilient all around those aspects if we have prepared some. Mm-hmm. So resilient is this thing. The other thing is, when you have a disaster, you want to be able to respond and not have to react. Of course, reacting is you're getting sucker punched and you're just surviving. But if you respond, then it means you have some things in your toolbox, so to speak, your mental and emotional, as well as your kits. So that's always good, is to be resilient. Another thing is that people can make this more of a lifestyle, and maybe people are getting back to that a little bit with all the things that we don't know going on in the world or in the government, the secret things, whatever. But for us to be more resilient, we can make it more of a lifestyle. For example, people could give gifts like what you've seen in my bug out bag for birthdays, for graduations.
That's a great idea.
You should give things that have a lasting value, and not just things that are here and now, instant gratification. Mm-hmm. But think ahead for people, encourage them. Another thing is that if the next huge disaster to hit us is 5 years out, that means if you're planning today, you're thinking, oh, I have a 15-year-old and I have a 17-year-old. They're going to be here. They're going to be able to help me. But if the disaster happens 5 years out, they're going to be 20 and 22. They're going to be gone. Mm-hmm. So prepare them now. Teach them now. So the next huge disaster may not, I mean, world is shaking, our society may not happen for 5 years, but your kids now, where are they going to be in that number of years? And also, if what age I'm at right now, if I can prepare, if I can carry that this bug out bag, but am I going to be able to, it was a little bit heavy, but am I going to be able to carry it in 5 more years? I'm going to be 5 years older. Will I have the physical stamina to carry it? So I need to think also about preparedness, knowing that life goes on. It changes. So prepare your kids now. They may not be around when it happens. You may think they are, but they may not be. And be able to manage your own health and your own, you know, preparedness in regards to advancing years.
Well, and you even alluded to it before we looked at the bag, was saying it's an evolving thing,
yeah,
right?
It is
and
evolving,
so that
yes.
In 5 years, you may have to change some of those things. Yeah. Obviously, you've got, I noticed you had some things in there that would have some expiration to them, so you'd want to update that.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. Those little mott things will get hard.
Yeah.
I had to throw the last bunch of those out, yeah.
Yeah. Well, what other kinds of tools would you say, or maybe the better way to ask this is, where can people turn for getting this information? Clearly, you taught yourself, you've learned a lot. But what are some best ways for the viewers that are looking at this video to learn how to do this too?
Ready.gov also has other checklists that you can go through. And again, not everything has to be gotten. Make it simple, make it doable, and don't get frustrated if you don't have it perfect or it doesn't look perfect. I also have a list of websites for preparedness. And really there's only a couple that I put out anymore. One of my favorite ones has been almost too old now. They're not updating it, so I took it off. I tried to update this, but ready.gov is the big one. Mm-hmm. That's FEMA and what have you. There's even sites on the ready.gov for kids to go to, and they have games, they have videos, they have things that teach them about it. It gets the kids involved in it. And also when you think about preparedness, you want to be aware of, do you have anybody that you care for that has disabilities that can't walk, or do you have pets? Ready.gov has stuff for that, those informational things too. How do you handle your pets? What things should you have prepared? Places for them to be sheltered at if you have to leave, etc. Also for people that are elderly or disabled, things like that. Be prepared. No. Theprepared.com was another good site. It's a private site, I mean, mm-hmm. but it's good. But this. Theprepared.com is a site that has a whole bunch of information. It covers all aspects of all kinds of disasters, information, whether it's medical, personal. They've done a lot of research. They've even said, like, here's the five top best things to buy in this, of like, you know, flashlights or lanterns or whatever. They've done research and put hours into it. Hmm. So I would go to a place like that. Someone's already done the legwork. I just get to go and enjoy it and pick out what works for me.
Yeah.
So that's here. There's also some FEMA.gov mobile apps you can put on your phone that gives you alerts and things like that. And you would have right there, even if all you have with you is your phone, you can go to this FEMA.gov mobile app and you can get information. Some of the documents, I mean, you would have access to what the website has. And getting alerts and emergency disaster tips. I have some things here also about where to buy long-term storage food, whether it's powdered milk, all kinds of food, ready food, like, you know, the Mountain House things where you just add water and eat, or it's like the flour and the dehydrated eggs and all that kind of stuff.
Sure.
So there's just a lot of stuff here that that can go on the web, your links too. But that would be the main thing. And even like the ready.gov, there's a place where you can go where it will show you, if you're asked to, immediately go down and shut your gas off in your house, your propane, whatever. It shows you how to go down the stairs and do it. So if you think, I need this for dummies, it's on the website. They have thought of everything. It is so extensive and done well, but people almost don't even know it's there.
Yeah.
But you could spend hours going on that and knowing how to. If I was a woman and I never had shut off the gas before, I could do that and I could follow it.
You know, I'm a cheat sheet guy. I love cheat sheets. Not that I ever used those in school or anything. But the point of a cheat sheet for me was, it was like I learned software.
Yeah.
So you could learn, you know, a book this big. That's not my mode of learning.
Yeah.
Show me this is how we're going to, this is where we're starting, this is where we want to get to, yeah. And here's 10 steps to follow.
Yep.
And then you can fill in all of the 10 steps for every 10 step that there exists as yeah. you learn.
Yeah.
And so what it sounds like here is that there's been people that have prepared those cheat sheets basically
they
for
have.
You. So we don't have to spend hours again
yeah.
and try to reduce the complexity and the feeling of overwhelming of finding all this out on our own.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it's all there on the internet, and just take some time to do it. If you feel uncomfortable with that, find somebody who's maybe, should I say, younger or who manages the internet better, someone who knows this information, and ask, well, this looks good to me. What do you think? You know, and actually, it's good to know other people that are doing this and to share your ideas so you aren't doing it in isolation. No one could know all the things that you need to know about preparedness. It's good to have several minds together and be thinking of
That's
this and
great
that.
Tip.
It's a good thing to do if
yeah.
in your family and stuff like that.
Yeah, yeah, great. Is there anything else that you wanted to share with us today, Julie?
I
know you have
so.
A lot of information here, so.
I think I mentioned the thing about bring your kids into it, because think about it. If the disaster that happens next, the big one, has in 5 or 7 years, who's making those decisions in 5 or 7 years? It's the people who are 18 and 19 now,
so
who are going to be into college. They're going to go out and be the decision makers, the people who have things. So it's good to bring up kids with this mindset also, because they're going to be the people that are going to be dealing with it.
Yeah.
And depending on how old you are or whatever, but bring in your kids and your grandkids.
You had a self-powered radio. My question is this, is what are the best sources? Like, what would you recommend for people when something is happening, even if it may not be directly impacting where you're at, or it could be where, it might be happening where you work, but
yeah.
not where you live.
Right.
It could be isolated like that or vice versa. But what's the best tips that you would give, or what are some tips? I always like that. What are some tips that you would give people for getting real-time information?
Some of these documents also, like ready.gov, it tells you to have your family pick somebody maybe outside of your community, like a cousin or a aunt or somebody. That can be a contact person. And that if you can't connect with people right in your own area, contact somebody. You also have places where you would meet, like, you know, in a disaster or like a earthquake or whatever, who's the contact person?
Mm-hmm.
Everybody, if you can't do it within, you try to find another person that would be the contact person
yeah.
for your family. So they have ways to help people connect with your loved ones to try and get around problems for communication. If you, like we have a fire too, you always are supposed to have your family say, we're gonna meet by the tree over
mm-hmm.
there. You mm-hmm. do the same thing here too. If things really go down bad in Benton County, where do I get found? If Scott
mm-hmm.
wants to find me, where should I tell him I'm most likely going to try to travel to? If
yeah.
and I would, we would have a place.
Yeah. Well, thank you for bringing that up, because I was sitting there thinking about, we do drills
yeah.
for fire
yes.
and tornadoes. Outside of that, I don't think we drill much anymore. So that would be another good
yeah.
maybe way to be prepared, is to let people
yeah.
know how to do that and actually practice some of those
yeah,
things.
Yeah, and ready.gov has actually documents that you can sit down with your family and work on and write them up. And you can, again, you can put them on a thumb drive. You can also have hard copy in case you can't use a computer. But it gives everybody thought, and the kids get to have say over some things
mm-hmm.
and input into it. And so they do have it can be a way for your family to come together, especially now when we're sheltering in place. This would have been a good time to be going to these websites and pulling together the family to say, what if the next time this happens, it's really worse?
Yeah.
What can we do now to plan for that?
Yeah. All right.
Okay.
Well, thank you so much, Julie, for being part
it's
of this today and sharing all this information. This is incredible stuff to know. And one of the things that really just stuck out to me was, and this word has come up again, was resilient.
Yes.
And how you mentioned that being prepared helps you be resilient, because adversity is going to happen.
Yes.
And our resilience really shapes how we how we move
respond
forward through that. Exactly.
And not react.
Respond and not react. So, again, thank you so much. We'll have links for the information that you have. And we want to thank you for sitting in and learning. I hope that you enjoyed all of this incredible information that we have today. Again, we're above the influence. And one of the reasons that this is so important for us is that it helps you understand all of the different ways that we can be more prepared in our life. Thanks for watching.
Things too. How do you handle your pets? What things should you have prepared? Places for them to be sheltered at if you have to leave, et cetera. Also for people that are elderly or disabled, things like that. Be prepared. No, no. Theprepared.com was another good site. It's a private site, I mean, mm-hmm. but it's good. I need to take a drink of water here. Okay.
Go ahead, Bill. Feel free to take them out.
Here it is. I just found this site. We're off, right?
He's going to he'll cut this out. That's the power of not having to be this doing this live.
Yep. Okay. Okay, we can just start again. But this theprepared.com is a site that has a whole bunch of information. It covers all aspects of all kinds of disasters. Information, whether it's medical, personal, they've done a lot of research. They've even said, like, here's the five top best things to buy in this, of like, you know, flashlights or lanterns or whatever. They've done research and put hours into it. So I would go to a place like that. Someone's already done the legwork. I just get to go and enjoy it and pick out what works for me. Yeah. So that's here. There's also some FEMA.gov mobile apps you can put on your phone that gives you alerts and things like that. And you would have right there, even if all you have with you is your phone, you can go to this FEMA.gov mobile app and you can get information on some of the documents. I mean, you would have access to what the website has and getting alerts and emergency disaster tips. I have some things here also about where to buy long-term storage food, whether it's powdered milk, all kinds of food, ready food, like, you know, the Mountain House things where you just add water and eat, or it's like the flour and the dehydrated eggs and all that kind of stuff.
Sure.
So there's just a lot of stuff here that that can go on the web, your links too. But that would be the main thing. And even like the ready.gov, there's a place where you can go where it will show you, if you're asked to, immediately go down and shut your gas off in your house, your propane, whatever. It shows you how to go down upstairs and do it. So if you think, I need this for dummies, it's on the website. They have thought of everything. It is so extensive and done well, but people almost don't even know it's there.
Yeah.
But you could spend hours going on that and knowing how to. If I was a woman and I never had shut off the gas before, I could do that and I could follow it.
You know, I'm a cheat sheet guy. I love cheat sheets. Not that I ever used those in school or anything. But the point of a cheat sheet for me was like I learned software. So you could learn, you know, a book this big. That's not my mode of learning.
Yeah.
Show me this is where we're starting, this is where we want to get to, and here's 10 steps to follow.
Yep.
And then you can fill in all of the 10 steps for every 10 step that there exists as you learn.
Yeah.
And so what it sounds like here is that there's been people that have prepared those cheat sheets basically
for you.
So we don't have to spend hours again and try to reduce the complexity and the feeling of overwhelming of finding all this out on our own.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it's all there on the internet, and just take some time to do it. If you feel uncomfortable with that, find somebody who's maybe, should I say, younger or who manages the internet better, someone who knows this information, and ask, well, this looks good to me. What do you think? You know. And actually, it's good to know other people that are doing this and to share your ideas so you aren't doing it in isolation. No one could know all the things that you need to know about preparedness. It's good to have several minds together and be thinking of
That's
this and that.
Tip.
It's a good thing to do within your family and stuff like that.
Yeah, yeah, great. Is there anything else that you wanted to share with us today, Julie?
I
know you have
so.
A lot of information here. So
I think I mentioned the thing about bring your kids into it, because think about it. If the disaster that happens next, the big one, it's in 5 or 7 years, who's making those decisions in 5 or 7 years? It's the people who are 18 and 19 now, who are going to be into college. They're going to go out and be the decision makers, the people who have things. So it's good to bring up kids with this mindset also, because they're going to be the people that are going to be dealing with it.
Yeah.
Depending on how old you are or whatever, but bring in your kids and your grandkids.
You had a self-powered radio. My question is this, is what are the best sources? Like, what would you recommend for people when something is happening, even if it may not be directly impacting where you're at, or it could be where, it might be happening where you work, but not where you live.
Right.
It could be isolated like that or vice versa. But what's the best tips that you would give, or what are some tips? I always like that. What are some tips that you would give people for getting real-time information? I mean, we don't want to get it off of Facebook, really, but that's where a lot of people do get stuff. So what would you recommend?
I guess in those situations, you may not have much information, but I mean, this has NOAA alerts, weather alerts, emergency alerts, that could help.
So clarify something, NOAA doesn't cover only, like if there was some type of other disaster, is that also covered on those weather bands, do you know?
I don't know. I wanna say it's emergency alerts.
Okay.
So yeah, and the apps, well, of course the app on the phone would cover all kinds of alerts. I know that they do use ham radio when communications are knocked down,
right.
Cell towers or communication satellites or whatever, ham radio works. And that's why even our county here has partnered with ham radio so that if we lost all of our cell phones and the communication grid, we have ham radio that can come into the EOC and
sure.
and help out or do whatever they do, wherever they do it, and they're together.
Sure.
The other thing is some of these documents also, like ready.gov, it tells you to have your family pick somebody maybe outside of your community, like a cousin or a aunt or somebody, that can be a contact person. And that if you can't connect with people right in your own area, contact somebody. You also have places where you would meet, like, you know, in a disaster or like a earthquake or whatever, who's the contact person?
Mm-hmm.
Everybody, if you can't do it within, you try to find another person that would be the contact person
yeah.
for your family. So they have ways to help people connect with your loved ones to try and get around problems for communication. If you, like when you have a fire too, you always are supposed to have your family say, we're gonna meet by the tree over
mm-hmm.
there. You
mm-hmm.
do the same thing here too. If things really go down bad in Benton County, where do I get found? If Scott
mm-hmm.
wants to find me, where should I tell him I'm most likely gonna try to travel to?
Yeah.
We would have a place.
Yeah, well, thank you for bringing that up because I was sitting there thinking about, we do drills
yeah.
for fire
yes.
and tornadoes. Outside of that, I don't think we drill much anymore. So that would be another good
yeah.
maybe way to be prepared is to let people
yeah.
know how to do that and actually practice some of those
yeah,
things.
Yeah, and ready.gov has actually documents that you can sit down with your family and work on and write them up. And you can, again, you can put them on a thumb drive. You can also have hard copy in case you can't use a computer. But it gives everybody thought, and the kids get to have say over some things
mm-hmm.
and input into it. And so they do have it can be a way for your family to come together, especially now when we're sheltering in place. This would have been a good time to be going to these websites and pulling together the family to say, what if the next time this happens, it's really worse?
Yeah.
And what can we do now to plan for that?
Yeah. All right.
Okay.
Well, thank you so much, Julie, for being part of this today and sharing all this information. This is incredible stuff to know. And one of the things that really just stuck out to me was, and this word has come up again, was resilient.
Yes.
And how you mentioned that being prepared helps you be resilient because adversity is going to happen.
Yes.
And our resilience really shapes how we
respond
forward through that. Exactly.
And not react.
Respond and not react. So again, thank you so much. We'll have links for the information that you have. And we want to thank you for sitting in and learning. I hope that you enjoyed all of this incredible information that we have today. Again, we're above the influence. And one of the reasons that this is so important for us is that it helps you understand all of the different ways that we can be more prepared in our life. Thanks for watching.